David sang the praises of the glory of Jehovah. Paul preached that all is lost save knowing Christ. Little John said he is precious. By leaning on his bosom, so for a moment may I humbly testify. Did I mention that I love him? How I worship and adore. How many songs can be sung about God's Son? There are not enough words, enough notes in the music to tell the story of all the saints.
I believe all the songs that's ever been written, that one right there fit the opening of this service. Did I mention that I love him? And it says, that's all I got to say. Amen. That's all Sister Dale had to say, because she truly did love the Lord, didn't she? No doubt about it. Amen. We are here today to celebrate the life Sister Dale Stevens Woodard, address 6163 Rooks Road in Patterson. She was born November 30th, 1939 in Ware County, Georgia. Left this world to be with Jesus July the 1st, 2022. At 82 years, 7 months, and 1 day. Amen. She was a native and lifelong resident of Ware County. She owned and operated Dale's Beauty and Barbershop for 42 years. She was a member of the Emerson Park Full Gospel Center, where she was a pianist for nearly 50 years. She also filled in at other churches when they needed a pianist. Amen. And I'm telling you what, when she sat down behind that piano, it was anointed. When she sat down behind that piano, I'm telling you, she blessed my soul many a time. Amen. It says she loved music deeply and loved her family, and we know that she did. Amen. Hallelujah. I tell folks all the time, you know, whenever we do a service it's for a lady and she has a bunch of children, you know, whenever we see them and their prayer requests, most time it's not for them, but it's for their children. Amen. And so that's the way Sister Dale was. Amen. She wanted her children to go to heaven. Amen. Hallelujah to God forevermore. She was a daughter of the late Mark Miller Stevens and Katie Lou Morgan Stevens. She was also preceded in death by her husband, Charles Woodard, and 3 siblings, Helen Owens, Jerry Davis, and Reverend John Stevens Sr. She was survived by her children, Charlene Leverett, Allen of Patterson, Chuck Woodard, Julie, and Jason Woodard, Jennifer Gorday, both of Waycross. Her grandchildren, Dan Woodard of Nashville, Tennessee, Kevin Woodard, Hart of Waycross, Georgia, Dalton Leverett, Christy of Patterson, Georgia. Oh, forgive me, is this Ellie Woodard? Ellie Woodard of Waycross, Georgia, Easton Law of Waycross, her great-grandchildren, McCray Woodard and Adelise Leverett, and numerous other nieces, nephews, and other relatives, amen, and a lot of friends that loved her, amen, count me among those, amen. You know, I thought as Sister Dale on that beauty shop for many, many years, amen, and all the clients she had. You know, the good thing about it, when you went to see Sister Dale, you sure wanted to look better when you left than you did when you went in there. And I believe they did, amen. She had her clientele, amen, and praise God. But she was in a good business, and she did a good job, didn't she, amen? And I appreciate her, and I appreciate everything. I appreciate this family. A lot of memories, amen. I want to read one scripture right here, amen. Then we're going to have another song, amen. And then Sister Charlene's going to come in just a minute. But you know, Jesus said in John 11:25-26, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. Believest thou this? Amen. You know, all you got to do is believe. Only believe. Jesus said, believeth in me. Amen. And I'm telling you what, let me just urge you right now. We're going to do some more in just a little bit. But let me just pray and believe right now that somebody's going to get saved here this morning. Wouldn't that be good? I don't believe anything and would make Sister Dale any prouder than to have somebody give their heart to Jesus. Or maybe somebody, maybe on the fence, getting off the fence and giving your life to him. And I'm telling you that you'll never regret it. That's one thing, you'll never regret it. Let us pray one more time. Heavenly Father God, we thank you, Lord God. And God, I can just see Sister Dale in heaven right now, God. And I can hear her many times mention that she loved the Lord, God. And God, she just didn't serve the Lord with lip service, God, but she served him with her life, Lord, and we praise you for that. Thank you for her ministry, God, and her life and what she did. And God, now we just pray, God, that you'd anoint the rest of this ongoing service, this ongoing celebration, God, as we give you praise, glory, and honor in the mighty name of Jesus. We do pray. Amen.
Jasper walls. just one request I make of you. Look for me, for I will be there too. I realize when you arrive, there'll be so much to view.
Family, I appreciate everyone coming. Most of you know that I'm Charlene, the daughter. And anybody that knew my mother, what I'm about to say, you could say that was her.
Amen.
Me and her were at a funeral one time, and the daughter got up and talked a little bit about the daddy. And when we got in the car and all, and she talked about how nice that was, and I said, well, Mama, I really thought this would get me off the hook. I said, would you like that? And she said, well, yeah, that would be nice. But I really honestly thought she was going to say, no, that's okay, I understand, but she didn't. And those that know of you know her know that would be just like her to do that. There's a couple of things that she wanted read, and first of all, I was going to write all this down, but I just couldn't do that. And if I lose myself, that's fine, because all I can do is talk to you from my heart. I don't want the last few days, few weeks, even the few years to define who my mother was. My mother was a strong woman. She pulled herself up by her own shoelaces, and she made it happen. You've heard of people that said they made it happen. Well, my mama made it happen.
Amen.
And the things that she went through, the things she battled, I seen her stand strong. She raised us to be strong.
Yes.
And I'm thankful for that. I'm thankful She was not just a mama, she was a mother. She was there. She loved her children, her grandchildren. That was her heart. I have not told my brothers this. My mother's last request on this earth was for her three children and her only to be in a room and to talk of all things. That happened in the last 3 weeks. God answered prayer. And I told her after that, I said, Mama, your prayers was answered. So I knew that she was ready. After that, I said, she can be released now because that prayer God answered.
Hallelujah.
But there's a scripture in 2 Samuel 22 and 30. It says, by thee have I run through a troop. By my God have I leaped over a wall. Every time I have heard that scripture or I've heard that scripture preached, I think that is my mama. That is my mama. And to stand here and to put everything into this scripture, I don't have time. But I can tell you this, she was an encourager. And when she told you everything would be okay, you knew it was going to be okay. They can't nobody tell you on this earth that everything's going to be all right like your mama.
Amen.
But when she did, you just knew everything was going to be okay.
Amen.
And I'm thankful. I'm thankful for her. When we were in UF, the pain was so great. I've never seen my mother cry too many times, but I seen her cry through the suffering. And I was with her about 24/7 the last 3 weeks. Would not leave her. But I seen one night we were in, particularly in UF, she began to cry, and I began to cry and pray. And she said, Lord, if this is it, if there is no better, she said, I want you to take me on. And she said, Jesus, I want to see you. And we began to talk through her pain. And it's like I was actually helping her to pack and go on a trip. And I was helping pack her. And I said, Mom, I said, what is the first thing you want to see when you get there? She said, of course, Jesus. And she raised her hands in that hospital room that night, my friend, and she said, Jesus, I'm ready to go.
Amen.
I want to share this also. The day that she passed, I was able to bring her home that week. That Monday, we got home. And I wish my brothers could have seen the relief and the sigh she had on her face. When the CNA came in, she talked about, Miss Dale, I'm so glad you're home. She smiled at her. She said, me too. And she thanked her for all she done. That Tuesday, God is so faithful. That Tuesday, Alan was on the lawnmower and he said, I need you to come out. And he knew I wouldn't leave her very long. He said, it won't take but 2 minutes. Behind our house was a rainbow. It had not even rained.
Hallelujah.
I'm not saying there wasn't a few clouds in the sky, but it was nothing to me that would make a rainbow be there. That rainbow was there.
Yes.
That Wednesday, I had walked out briefly to water some flowers up front. Right there at her bedroom window, I have her bird bath. There lay perfectly right there in front of that bird bath a small white feather. And I said, thank you, Lord.
Amen.
Because in Psalm 91, I believe about 4, it says, he'll cover you with his feathers. So when I see a feather, or when you see a feather, there's a meaning behind that.
Amen.
That means you're covered by under his feathers.
Hallelujah.
So when you see that, don't take for granted. That means that he's covering you with his feathers.
Amen.
Then on, let me back up. And this is exactly why I want to write it down. But anyway, she passed on that Friday afternoon. And up until this point, I had got in her ear and I had thanked her. I told her, I said, I thank you for raising me the way you raised me. I said, I thank you for everything that you've done. Anything I could say, I said it. Not that I felt like it, but I just wanted her to know one more time. And I kissed that forehead, and I kissed that face, and I kissed them hands. But at that point, I had seen the suffering so much until I began to say, Lord, take her. And I had prayed way back, a couple years probably ago. I said, Lord, don't take her from me quick. I said, that's all I ask you. Don't take her quickly from me. God honored that. He took her slowly. I seen the light begin to go out a year ago. She told me and Jason last Christmas, she said, I'm telling y'all I won't be here this Christmas. Jay said, oh, Mama, you will. She hit it head on. She knew the light was going out, and I knew that she was getting ready to go. But there is a perfect peace that I cannot explain, this world cannot give it, that I have today. When I cry, I don't cry because I know I'm worried about where she's at. There's no doubt in my mind. But when she passed that Friday afternoon, the hospice nurse was there and stayed with us. And when she passed, I believe, Brother Richard, it was at the time that she actually began to cross over. She opened her eyes, and she saw something, my friend, that we were not able to see. That right eye wasn't blind no more because of what she was seeing. That nurse said, I've done this for 25 years, and I've never seen that. It touched her heart. She was ready to go, and I'm thankful for it. There's a couple things I could go on and on that I want to read that she requested. This is on Mother's Day of 95. Both of these I'm going to read is from Jason. Me and Chuck could walk in the room and it was okay. But that baby walked in the room and she lit up like a light bulb. I'm telling you, that was her baby. And everybody knew that was her baby. It says, Dear Mom, I didn't get you very much this year for Mother's Day. So I thought I could at least sit down and write them. First of all, I would like to thank you for all the times you supported me in school. There was sometimes whenever I would get depressed and I would feel down, but you... He's got terrible handwriting. I would get depressed and feel down, but for some reason I could always look up and see you were there. You have always been the limelight of my life and always supported me. I sometimes think of you not being here with me, and it brings me to tears to think of how I could make it without you. As I write this letter, I think and actually cry because of thought. Is horrifying what I would do if you weren't around. You have always been there when no one else was. You would always shelter me and tell me how you loved me, and it would always make things better. I hope in the 24 years you've known me that I have made you proud for you to be my mother, and I always hope that you will be. I don't care how much money I ever have because I want you to know if you think you can't ever make it, you know you will always have someone there to hold your hand. I couldn't ever forget how you've treated me even though I've gotten mad for the slightest things. I would do anything you ask me, because no one couldn't ever replace you, my mama, because you are simply the greatest. One word sums it all up, Mama. I hope one day when someone asks who I am, you can simply say that's my son, and I know he loves me, and we would do anything that I asked. Whenever I go to Atlanta, and this is my mama up and down, I hope you don't worry about me getting in the wrong crowd, and because you have raised me better than that. I want you to know that if I ever get married, I would be proud to have half the woman that you are. You are a hard worker, and it's paid off. You have three children to be very proud of, because I think we all came a long ways. Simply You were there when no one else was, so don't ever forget or even doubt my love for you, because I can assure you it is always there. Happy Mother's Day and many, many, many more to come. I will love you always in the very deepest of my heart. Moving on, I know others have to come. This is a, I guess, Jason, you done it. I don't know if it was an essay or what it was, but anyway, here we go. Tucked away in the Zachary Building in Waycross, Georgia, rests Eunice's Barbershop, where the warm sun comes peeking through the large glass windows to warm the barber standing behind her ninth undeciding customer of the day. When you walk through the doors of the barbershop to get a haircut, you feel right at home. The shop is not one you will find in Beverly Hills, California, but a place you would find in an old country town. It's about 20 foot by 30 feet in size, painted nicely with high cathedral ceilings, looking like those in the 1700s. The old brassy-looking hat racks are loaded with hats worn by older men, reminding me of limbs that are outweighed by large southern doves. As you sit down, the creeping sun makes you feel at home, warming you head to toe. Before getting too deep into the reading the daily newspaper, you are greeted with a big welcoming smile from a 5'5" slender woman with blondish brown hair. She is standing behind a small teary-eyed child, frustrated about getting a haircut, but convinced and reassured by the barber not to cry or he will not get any chewing gum. Hi. She says hi as you walk in, and I'll be right with you. And then quickly she gets back to work on the child, whose tears have now dried and who is smacking wildly on the gum like a cow chewing hay. This slender barber grew up with one older brother and two older sisters in Emerson Park, located in Waycross, Georgia. She graduated from Waycross High in 58, immediately attending Waycross Wear Tech, where she took cosmetology for exactly 1 year. She patiently waited for the opportunity to have her own business working for other people until finally, in the spring of 1988, she earned the chance and money to make her start. She now operates a very adequate business, offering her kindness and barbering skills to anyone walking through the doors. It is a place where you can rest, where you can get a great haircut, someone willing to listen to your problems, and a little reassurance, all for just $6. I believe he wrote this when he was born. When 6 o'clock rolls around, the work day is not over. She closes down and turns off the red, white, and blue barber pole, spinning out of control and reflecting the colors of the American flag. She quickly but carefully sweeps the excess hair lying on the shiny, hard tile floor, and Valcom and carelessly hanging hair off of the bulky barber chairs. After everything is done, she looks up and rushes off in her car to care for her 84-year-old mother. Though she might be drained and weary from work, she spends an hour loving and caring for her mother, just as her mother did her. There's a couple of stories that I want to quickly, one more thing I want to read, and I'm sorry that this is lengthy. I really didn't think I'd be up, but this was back in 1986. My grandmother sent her a birthday card, and it says, "Daughter, this brings a loving wish for your birthday and always, too. Every day, in every way, may life be good to you." My grandmother writes, "Dale, it has been a many years since you was a baby, and I hugged you in my arms and loved you, but I have that same love for you now. Thank the Lord for letting us be together another year. Love your mama." Well, my friend, my grandma is holding her baby today. But when her and Aunt Helen, when they were, there was really two sets of children, my Uncle John and my Aunt Jerry, and they were closer in age, and then my Aunt Helen and Mama. And my Aunt Helen and Mama could kind of get into some trouble, not meaning to, but they had got new baby carriages, and they were so proud of them, and their Aunt Mildred lived somewhere, she said, to be about Albany Avenue, and they were so proud and so happy. Well, they took off from Gilchrist Park and headed to Aunt Mildred's house. When they got there, my Aunt Mildred was glad to see them and all that. Well, she got word back to my grandma. When they got home, they got their behinds fried because that bubble got busted. There was another time in 1948, my mother was there when the B-29 bomber crashed, and it made an impression on her mind. She said all she knew was there was bodies laying everywhere in Gilchrist Park. The pressure cooker at the school, she talked about one time, exploded, and there was food all on the ceiling and the wall, she said, everywhere. There was another time that she was playing in the dirt road, and she almost got run over, and it made my grandma mad. Now, my grandma was small in stature, but don't think she didn't have no fire, because she had the fire. She was the whipper in the family, and she'd take anything she could get her hands on. That's what they got whipped with. But my mother got, she knew she'd almost got in trouble, or was going to get in trouble. She hid under the house, and they was calling her. All the neighborhood come out calling her and couldn't. Finally, one of them said, well, we're going to call the police. And Mama said, here she come crawling up from up under the house. She didn't want the police. Another all-night sings were great with my Aunt Helen and my Aunt Jerry. She loved sweets. Her thing was to buy sweets for Jason. He wasn't ever on them like me and Chuck. And anyway, just didn't. But she'd hide them in the trunk of the car to keep herself from getting into them in the middle of the night. Well, guess what? In the middle of the night, she goes outside to the trunk of the car. Or she would have you to take them sweets and hide them in your room. And then if you heard something in the middle of the night, like a rat, well, that would be her. If she couldn't find them, she would wake you up and say, Charlene, Jason, where'd y'all put them sweets at? She loved sweets. There was another time that there was a nursing program in school. I ought to get Johnny up here. He's the one that knows all the history. But anyway, the first time she tried a cigarette, these girls left the hospital and they tried some cigarettes. When she got home, my grandmother had these feelings. You couldn't hide nothing from her. And my mama was the same way. Just had these feelings. And she asked, she said, Bessie Dale. And Bessie was her first name. She didn't like it and dropped in high school. That was her grandmother's name, which was a saint. She just never could get. She said, have you been smoking? She said, no, Mama, I ain't been smoking. Well, she had been. She said, I never lit another one. I want to thank you all today for coming, and I appreciate having the honor to stand for my mother one more time and give honor to her.
Amen.
Yes, amen.
Amen.
When the time comes and I'm standing at the river that separates the two worlds that I love, torn between my precious friends and my family and the place of peace that's waiting up above, hold my hand and stay there by my side. And when I finally step into the tide, celebrate me home, celebrate me there, celebrate me in that land of wonder where nothing can compare. Celebrate me in that place, celebrate me saved by grace. Don't just sit and weep
because I'm gone.
Celebrate me home.
I have spent most of my life on earth preparing to take the trip from here to heaven's throne. With the shield and word of God to guide me, it's a comfort knowing I am not alone. So when I take my final fleeting breath and fade into the gentle sleep of death, celebrate me home, celebrate me there, celebrate me in that land of wonder where nothing
Well, Dale was my aunt, and I didn't think it would be quite so hard, Charlene, to stand up here and talk about her. Not as hard as it is. Aunt Dale was somebody that I so admired. There's not very many women that would have been a housewife, a mother of three, and then found herself having to be a single parent taking care of a home and children. She got herself up and she somehow found out about a grant that she could get to go to the school to be a beautician and a barber. And she did that. A lot of women would have just sat down and just gone home to mom and daddy. But she grabbed up things and she got herself up and she went and got an education, something that she could be able to raise her children, take care of her children and herself. She did that, and I admire her for that. I am so grateful that not only was she a great beautician, and you're right, you'd go, and we would drive up from Jacksonville just for her to cut our hair because she was so good at it. Plus, we enjoyed visiting. But she was such a special person. There were so many times that when my mother had a stroke, lived 7 years as a bed patient in Jacksonville, that she and Charlene would drive up and fix my mama's hair for her because she was not able to care for herself. And Mama would just light up when Dale and Charlene would show up. I think a lot of it, she was just tired of me and my sister, but she just loved her baby sister. And I so, Charlene, appreciate that you and your mama took those many trips to see mom and help with her and take care of her and delight her heart. I was going to say many more things, but Charlene sort of taken the time up for today. So, But the things she said were so, so true. Dale was so wonderful. And the few times we got to see her at the nursing home, she was not happy there. She did not want to stay there. And she reached that place where she didn't want to stay here at all. So I'm so grateful that God has taken her home. You know, Dale's life preached. And you know, all of our lives preach. Now, we don't have the training our brother has, but we are trained up to let our lives preach to the people we come in contact with. And she did that. In that barbershop, people coming in, we would come up and we'd go out to eat, go to dinner. Never, never did we go out and eat that two or three people didn't walk up to Aunt Dale and carry on a conversation. She was well-liked and well-loved by many people in Waycross, and I know why. She was just a delightful person. But I want to read you what I think is the description of Dale. It's found in 1 Corinthians 13. I'm reading out of the Amplified Bible. It says, love endures long and is patient and kind, and she was. Love never is envious. It doesn't boil over with jealousy. It's not boastful or vainglorious. It does not display itself haughtily. She didn't. It is not conceited, arrogant, inflated with pride. It's not rude or unmannerly and does not act unbecomingly. Love, God's love in us, does not insist on its own rights or its own way, for it is not self-seeking, and she wasn't. It is not touchy or fretful or resentful. It takes no account of the evil done to it. It pays no attention to a suffered wrong. And that describes my Aunt Dale. Does not rejoice at injustice or unrighteousness, but rejoices when right and truth prevail. Love bears up under anything and everything that comes. Dale bared up under any and everything that came, is ever ready to believe the best of every person. Its hopes are fadeless under all circumstances. It endures everything without weakening, and she did. Love never fails, and Dale didn't. She never failed. She was a wonderful mother. She was a wonderful daughter, but she, to me, was a wonderful aunt. A wonderful friend, and I will always hold dear the memories of her and our visits at home, at my home, and the times we spent together, even as children. I'm 4 years younger than Dale was, though she didn't like to admit that, but she was always somebody special for me in my life. She and I had a love and a bond that I cherish, and I want to thank Dalton and his wife. And I want to thank you, Alan. Alan has been such a wonderful man. He has helped Charlene through this, Dalton and his wife. I want to thank you for being the man and caring for my Aunt Dale. Auntie, as I used to like to call her. But thank you so much for being there for her and helping with her. That's a thing I think you will receive a great reward. So I thank each one of you, like Charlene said, for coming. I thank you, Aunt Dale would be so proud to see everybody. She would be especially proud, Charlene, of the way she looked today. She looked very nice. That was always important to Dale, that her hair be fixed right and that she looked pretty. And she had just told us the other day in the nursing home that the purple and lavender were her favorite colors. So I think today, Charlene, she would have been very pleased with everything that's happened. And I thank each one of you. I love you dearly. I love my family. And us cousins, let me say, we want to have a gathering sometime. We're discussing it, and I hope that comes to pass. Family's so very important. Yes, and you know, Dale loved in such a great way. I want us to, as a family, honor that and continue to walk in our ministry. We all have a life that we preach, whether it's to each other, but we preach to our children, to one another, and to the lost out in the world. And brother, I pray with you that today, if there's anybody that don't know Jesus, you need to know him. This one day will be you. I don't care if you're 2 years old. My daddy one time said, Dale, Aunt Dale and Helen and us were sitting in the living room talking about Jesus coming again. And my daddy stuck his head around the corner. He says, well, one thing about it, if he don't come, you're going. So that's the truth. One day everyone will have their time. God bless you all. Thank you so much. And my Aunt Dale, I wish you could hear, but I love you. And I cherish you in the memory of you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Y'all pardon me, but I just got to say glory. I'm telling you, this has been a great service so far. Amen. And I tell you what, I have enjoyed it. Amen. Praise God. And I tell you what, it's just like we could just see her here all over again. Amen. With Sister Charlene. Amen. Praise God. And Ann. And I tell you what, I about feel unworthy coming up here behind them two great ladies. I'm telling you, amen. Hallelujah to God. But we do have so many good memories, amen, of Dale and Charlene and Emerson Park Full Gospel Center, amen. And you know, this is about Dale today, but, you know, I wasn't Pentecostal. I just wanted to be saved and satisfied when I did get saved, amen. And, you know, and I just wanted to go sit by my wife and just wait for Jesus to call me home, amen. But God had other ideas, and he had other plans, amen. And I thank God so much for sending me to the Emerson Park Full Gospel Center. My wife went there as a little girl, and she told me one day, she says, I think I'm going to start going to Brother John's church. That's where I went as a little girl, and so wasn't too many services. I was there, and I don't believe God could have sent me to a better place. Amen. Of all the churches on this earth, amen, and there's many good ones, amen. And then when God called me to preach, he put me under some people, amen, that tutored me along and raised me up and blessed me, amen. And I mentioned where we're at Liberty Christian Church, probably 15 or 20% of the time I mentioned Brother John and some of the things he taught me. Then I'll mention a song that Dale and Charlene sung, amen. So the memory lives on, amen. And they was always a blessing to me. And I thought the other day, I'm sure that Dale and Charlene got tired of me, because first thing I'd ask them everybody every service was, y'all sing Beulah Land. You remember that? I say, here he comes. We know what's coming. Amen. Praise God. But I love Beulah Land before I even knew who the man that wrote it. I can't think of his name now. Squire Parsons. I knew them and wanted them to sing it before I even knew who Squire Parsons was. Amen. And I'm telling you, they couldn't nobody sing it as good as Dale and Charlene. Amen. I'd cry like a baby. Amen. I've told people so many times that if I die, just leave my casket open and have somebody sing Beulah Land. If tears don't come to my eyes and a lump come to my throat, just go ahead and close the coffin and have church. Amen. But that's what a blessing it was. Amen. And when we went to Liberty Christian Church, we ain't much of singers, but a lot of those songs, says Charlene, I wrote them down. We got them. Amen. In that songbook. Amen. Hallelujah to God. It'll be different next time he comes to earth again. Amen. And different things like that. I'm not a rich man with silver and gold. All those songs, I think of them singing them. Amen. Yeah. Never, never, never left a service without being blessed. Amen. Wherever it was. Amen. Whether it was Full Gospel Center, anywhere Sister Dale was playing the piano, if we visited or we was there, it was a blessing. Amen. You know, I think a lot of times people take them blessings for granted. Yes. Amen. Hallelujah. But I'm telling you what, David played for Saul, didn't he? Running more evil spirits away. And I believe that's what it is. Amen. Praise God. And music was a big part of Emerson Park Full Gospel Center. It's a big part of our ministry. And Dale and Charlene, they were big in that. Amen. To me, like I said, I was 30 years old, but I was a baby in Christ. Amen. Hallelujah to God. I had a lot to learn, and I had some good teachers. Amen. And Sister Dale, she had that smile about her, and she could make you feel good when you felt bad. You know, you might be feeling bad one day, and she had that good smile about her to make you feel better. Amen. And never saw her that she didn't lift me up. Amen. She might have needed lifting up, But she'd lift me up. Amen. You know, some people that no matter what, you feel better when you leave them than when you went in or when you saw them. Amen. And that's the way Dale was. And Charlene just took it up too. And that just makes me feel so good. Amen. Family. Amen. You know, that's the good thing about it. We see nowadays where family kind of spreads out and don't get together like they ought to. But I'm telling you, Emerson Park Full Gospel Center, and I mentioned that because Dale and Charlene were so big there in it then. You know, we love church so much, we had two prayer meetings a week. Amen. People think, we tell people, say, we have prayer meetings on Tuesdays and Fridays. What? People don't even have prayer meeting once a week now. Amen. Don't get mad at me. It's true. Come on. Hallelujah to God. Well, we're not having Sunday nights anymore so the folks can have family time. What better family time than to be in God's house? Well, we don't have prayer meeting on Wednesday now because the youngins has got the recreation games to play. So we don't see that no more, amen. But like I was saying, that was such a big part of my life, them training and growing me in Jesus, amen, blessing me with the songs. Brother John blessing me with the message. Sister Charlene blessing me with messages, amen. She done good up here, but I'm telling you what, if you ever been in a church that she got turned loose with a message, amen, she blessed my heart, amen, hallelujah to God, because she always seemed to be so quiet. When she get anointed, you better look out, amen. When she got anointed, that devil knew he better hide him in a phone booth somewhere and call 911, amen. And this family, I love them, I'm telling you, I cannot say enough, and I know we spent a lot of time up here today. But I just enjoyed the time together. I enjoyed being there, enjoyed going when we'd get her hair cut up there, when Dale cut it, and then Charlene would cut it. And I ain't going to tell you, I got upset when Charlene told me she was moving. Amen. It's so bad my son has to cut my hair now. But I just love being with them. The friendship and the family time that we had, amen, all the get-togethers, amen. Even amen, praise God, with Helen and Jerry. We'd go to Jacksonville every now and then with them, and they'd come up here and just the family, amen. But Dale, she was so, you know, I got to thinking sometimes she kind of, in our older age, we can't move around like we used to and as quick as we used to be. But I think she's not slow anymore. No more legs, don't slow her down, amen, praise God, forevermore. She's rejoicing in heaven, shouting on the streets of glory, amen. We have a tendency to forget that, amen, praise God. The Bible says, I had not seen or ear heard nor entered into the hearts of man. What's in store of them that love the Lord, except it to be revealed by the Spirit, amen. Oh, well, we have a time when we get up there. We just think we have a time down here, amen. I just think, Brother Johnny, of all the wonderful times we had at the Emerson Park Full Gospel Center, and, you know, praise God, the shouting times, hallelujah. He might get mad at him, Brother Johnny, but I'm going to go ahead and tell you this. The Holy Ghost was moving, Sister Charlene, one night, and he was up there. He sang so long, he just had sweat pouring down. And I took a handkerchief. I wiped the sweat. I thought that was an honor to wipe the sweat off his brow, amen, while he was obeying God, amen. Hallelujah to God. That's what God will still do it if we'll let him. Amen. Amen. He'll still do it. And we can still have services like that. And we can still, praise God, feel that anointing. But Sister Dale was anointed every time she sung, every time her and Charlene got together. Amen. I can remember some of the last times, whether it was at Hosanna, amen, or Woodard Chapel, and heard she get behind that piano. Boy, bring back them old memories. It bring back them memories. Amen. Praise God. And she loved God. Charlene said how much she loved God. She did. She had the love of God on her face. Amen. She had that countenance. Hallelujah to God forevermore. She had that little small smile. It'd get to you. Yes. It'd get to me. Amen. Hallelujah to God. But how many blessings. You can't count the blessings that this family has given to me. Amen. And Sister Dale playing that piano. Amen. I just know sometimes when I was trying to learn how to sing, I still hadn't learned. She'd have a little head cocked, trying to pick me up, and I was way down. She'd pick me up. I don't believe she ever complained, amen. I don't believe she ever complained. I don't know why Brother John got him to lead the singing, amen. But she just kept going. She kept soldiering on, soldiering on, amen. She kept the faith, amen. Hallelujah to God. I'll try to quit right here. I ain't even read scripture yet, have I? Let me read you this right here. 23rd Psalm has got to mean so much more. You know, have you ever noticed sometimes you can just be saved for a long time and read the Bible and even preach a long time? Yes. And I've preached the Lord's Shepherd many times a year or so ago. I preached this and it just jumped out at me, amen. says, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over." And then this sixth verse a while back, amen, and a few of our church folks are here, and they can tell you. This sixth verse, whenever I read it, it just jumped out at me more than it ever has. "Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me." Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me. That means they're going to be right there with me. No matter where I go, I can look on this over the shoulder and I can see goodness. I can look over this shoulder and see mercy. They're right there with us. Amen. "Shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever." Amen.
Amen.
This is Charlene mentioned it. We that knew Dale knew that every day wasn't a day of roses. Amen. She struggled. She had times that she struggled. Amen. But you know what? She walked the walk and talked the talk and lived the life. And I believe she truly knew that goodness and mercy was following her. Sis Charlene?
Yes,
amen. Hallelujah to God. Amen. She fought. I'm telling you what, I tell our folks all the time since we've been where we've been now, and there's about 8 or 10 ladies that's kind of struggle. Single mamas, widows, ones. But they've kept the faith. They kept the faith. Nothing keeps them from serving God. Nothing keeps them when they can't be to be there. Nothing keeps them from paying their tithes and offerings. Amen.
Amen.
And I think of these ladies, and I said, when they get to heaven, the Bible teaches us, let no man steal our crown. There's a crown laid up, a crown of righteousness laid up. Amen.
Amen.
And I tell folks all the time, and I mention that when they get there, their crown's going to be so big, and it's going to have so many jewels in it. I put Sister Dale on that list, Sister Charlene.
Amen.
Amen. Because just think, and even you that serve God, how many times could you just throw up your hands and quit? How many times if you listen to the enemy, you say, well, I don't need to go to church tonight. I don't need to praise God tonight. I don't need to worship God tonight. I got a car payment due and don't have no money in the bank. I'm just going to throw up my hands. No. It'd be easy to do.
Amen.
Amen. But Sister Dale held on. She held on. She knew goodness and mercy was following her all the days of her life. She knew that one day she'd dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen. And I like John 14. Jesus said, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. God said, I go to prepare a place for you. All these years, there's been a mansion being prepared.
Amen.
For Sister Dale Woodard. Amen. It's going to be just what she wanted. Amen. It's going to be just whatever color she wanted, whatever interior she wanted. I believe it's going to be there. Because let me tell you something, God knew Sister Dale better than we ever could. And he knew what she wanted. And I believe it's going to be, I don't believe none of us going to get there and say, well, this ain't what I want. Now, I'm going to go ahead and say this. I'll make a lot of people mad at me. You get you a Bible that says, in my Father's house are many mansions.
Amen.
Yes. Amen. I had to live in a room down here. Amen. I got a room here and a room there. My Bible says, in my Father's house are many mansions. Jesus said, if it wasn't so, I'd have told you. If you want a little room when you get there, that's all right. It'll be good enough too. But I believe she inherited that mansion.
Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. I was blessed to visit their house many times. Charlene was coming up, and then Dale, and then out there before they moved to Patterson, and they had some pretty houses. Sister Dale got living in some pretty houses here lately. But you know what? It's nothing compared. Nothing compared. So when she made that fine, I believe she saw Jesus. It's rolling like you said. I believe when her eyes was fixed, they were fixed on Jesus. Amen. And I believe she took that last breath down here. Glory to God, you're talking about a mansion. You're talking about a place of happiness, peace, and joy. Amen. No more sadness, no more sickness, no more sorrow. Amen. We've been through some sorrow over the years together. Amen. We wept over a lot of caskets, and we wept in sick bed, in hospitals, amen.
Yeah.
Sister Dale ain't never got to worry about that no more.
Amen.
She's not going to be sad. She's not going to be sick. She's not going to be sorrowful ever again, amen. And I don't know if we're going to physically run in that spiritual place called heaven. But heaven's real, Amen. But I tell you what, I know her legs ache for many a year. Mine's been aching for a few years. Man, I can't wait to be turned loose in heaven. Amen. We might look out there one day and something we'll be racing. Me and Sister Dale racing. Glory to God. We can laugh. I'd rather laugh than cry. Amen. But the Bible says the half has not yet been told. We've only seen the half of it. Sister Dale's seen the other half. I love that song, I Can Only Imagine. Sister Dale don't have to imagine anymore. Glory to God. Her eyes was fixed on Jesus and he carried her home. Woo! All that imagination's gone. All that wondering if she had danced before him or bowed before him or what she'd do before him. She's doing it. Amen? You and I hadn't made it yet. We won't make it before long, though. I wish I had a whole afternoon to tell you Jesus is coming soon. He is. All signs of the times, amen. You don't have to be, old John Hagee says, you don't have to be a rocket scientist. We can see what's going on. We can see what's going on, amen. And I'm here to tell you this morning, this afternoon, amen. If you're not saved, you need to get saved. Yes. Sister Dale could tell you one more thing. If she could come back for one more minute, amen, praise God, one more hour, she'd tell you, get saved, get right. Yes. Be born again. Jesus told Nicodemus, said, you must be born again. You must be born again. There's no other way, no other name given unto men whereby we might be saved but the name of Jesus. Amen. David had that son. He died. Amen. And he said, I can't bring him back, but I can go to where he's at. We can't bring Sister Dale back. Amen. Hallelujah to God. She wouldn't come back if she could. Amen. But we can go to where she's at. And the only way to go to where she's at is to be saved, to be born again. Amen. Repent of your sins. Amen. Confess that Jesus is the Son of God. Believe it in your heart. Confess it. Believing in your heart that God rose him from, he was risen from the dead. Hallelujah. That doesn't take a rocket scientist to believe that either. Amen. Like I said before to many people, the only thing I regretted till I was 30 years old before I accepted Jesus, my Savior. All the wasted time. I'm telling you, you'll never regret it. You'll never regret. If you give your heart to Jesus, you'll never regret it. If you're born again, you'll never regret it. On this earth, and especially in eternity. In eternity. Amen. See, Charlene knew this lady. We know her. She stood up in Brother John's one day, and she says, I sure hope if I make it to heaven, they won't kick me out. I thought, they ain't going to kick you out if you make it there, because you got to be ready to go. Can't nobody just slip in there. Ain't nobody going to enter in like a thief. Amen. You got to be ready. Amen. And let me tell you, this afternoon, you got to be ready. You got to be ready. Yes. I'm glad God's a loving, caring, saving God. Amen. Hallelujah to God. I've seen little youngins get saved. I tell folks, some people think 12 years old is the age of accountability. I think when a youngin knows right or wrong. If it don't matter if the Holy Ghost conviction gets on their heart, amen. We had a little girl get saved 4 years old. God convicted her heart. She went to that altar rail, amen. Yes. I've been at the hospital before. Somebody called me, said my granddaddy's up there, and he's never been saved. He's always said there was no God. Would you please go? They said he ain't going to make it through the night. Will you please go? And I went up there to him, and they told me, he said he was a mean man. I don't usually have boldness like this, Brother Adam. I went in and introduced myself. I said, your family told me you was a mean man. He said, I am, son. I said, the doctor said you're not going to make it through the night. He said, they did. I says, wouldn't you like to go to heaven? Tears started coming. I ain't nothing now. I'm nothing. I'm just telling you. Tears started coming down. I said, wouldn't you like to go to heaven? He said, yes, son, I would. He said the sinner's prayer. He repented of his sins. Amen. I shook his hand, and I left. He went to heaven that night. Amen. That's the goodness of God. Don't wait, though. Don't wait. Yeah. If you're not ready, don't wait. I thank God for midnight salvations, but don't wait. Amen. Hallelujah to God. Yes. We're going to pray, and then Brother John's going to come singing. Once again, I thank you. Amen. Whenever I think of people that I have known in my lifetime, Sister Dale Wood is right there among them. Right there among, amen, the top, the cream of the crop. Amen. And you know what's good, too? I believe if any time that I would have ever needed her, she would have been there. Yes. Amen. No matter what, she would have been there. Amen. And it's an honor. It is an honor for me to be able to do part of this today. Amen. It's been a great service so far. Yes. Heavenly Father God, as we get ready to God, just close this service, and Brother Johnny, sing a beautiful song for us, God. And God, we thank you for Sister Dale, God. We thank you, God, for her life, God. And God, as we think back, God, over the many times and the times that we visited and the times that we saw her, God, whether it was at church or, God, at the beauty shop, wherever it might have been, Lord God, the love of God was shining through. The light of Jesus was shining out in this old world of darkness, God. We thank you for her, God. This world needs millions and millions and millions more like her, God. And God, let us be more like her. Let us be more like you. And God, let our light shine in these end times, Father. And God, if there's one here this afternoon that knows you not, one here that never accepted Jesus as Savior, I pray they're doing so right now. God, just repent of their sins, God. Your word tells us, God, if we'll repent, you're faithful and just to cleanse us of all our unrighteousness, God. God, your word tells us you'll write our name in the Lamb's Book of Life. And there'll be a mansion, God, when this life's over, we can inherit, just as Sister Dale inherited hers. But God, minister to all of us. We need you like never before in these last days. And Father, we just give you praise and glory and honor. In Jesus' mighty name we do pray. Amen.
Follow that, ain't it? But I'm the third string piano player. But I'm the bass player. Can I read one thing, Charlene? I was raised with these children, and Jason, he come around for it. We're much older than he is. We all got in trouble at Grandma's house and everywhere else. But I'll watch Aunt Dale. Yeah, I'm a cousin too. I'm on the latter side of the group. But I've watched her life. I've seen her, and I know her life.
Amen.
There's things I do not know, and I don't have to know. But it's in 2 Timothy 4. You know what it is, don't you? If anybody can say this, Aunt Dale can say it. I have fought a good fight.
Yep.
Can you say that today? I have finished my course. Everybody here's got a course.
That's right.
Aunt Dale's is done. Mine and yours is still on. Here's the most important, Brother Richard. I have kept the what?
Faith.
Faith. Yes. Here's where it gets good. Henceforth, there is laid up for me a crown of what? Righteousness.
Yep.
And it say which the president will give you.
Come on.
Or the queen of England. It says which the Lord, the righteous
Amen.
Judge, shall give me at that day.
That day.
Well, that day has come.
Yes.
The crown has been given.
Amen.
Paul went on to say, not to me only, but unto all them that also that love
his appearing.
Amen. 4 years ago, remember, I'm the third string. First, I'm a bass player by trade. But if you would, I would like everybody to sing it with me. 4 years ago, almost to the month, over in that room, Sister Dale asked me to sing this song.
Amen.
And it's been about 4 years since I played this song. So would y'all sing it with me so you won't hear my mistakes? It's
Amazing grace. Thank you.
Lord. We give you all glory and praise, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.